you find yourself a man have to go back to the crossroads. Oh, he find himself. It's so hard, but it's bad when there's someone to love you. They're jiving and they don't care. Man, have to go back to the crossroads before he find himself a man. Have to go back to the crossroads before he find himself a man. Have to go back to the crossroads before he find himself.
You worldwide, man.
Yeah.
Wow. So, London, how was London?
London was incredible. And I do mean that.
Big John. What? Shit, man. Come on. You ain't hear my theme music when I land, baby? You hear the horns? When I got here, you know what I mean? The king is back, baby.
And I got to holler at the homies that was out there, but I ain't seen them yet.
Yeah, let's go eat. Where you gonna eat at? Yeah, let's do that. I'm gonna go to, hey, what's the name of my hotel, bro?
When we were first granted access to Young Jeezy, he was in the middle of a world tour to promote his single with Rihanna.
All right, cool. So I'm waiting.
He agreed for cameras to follow him and document his life.
This nigga right there, he gave me my first $1 million check. Some nigga on the phone, I gotta go eat with this nigga. Conversation with him might turn into a check. See, now I'll tell you a true story, right? This nigga, he had a big-ass check for me, right? But I had money. So, like, when I first got signed and shit, like, I wasn't moving for money. I had my shit in a Louis Vuitton bag, so this nigga called me. He had this big-ass check for me. So I just kept getting in the runaround and shit. And I'll never forget it. I was getting on the jet, a private jet. I remember this nigga running down the runway with the check. Like, here you check, nigga. So I had to make the pilot stop the jet, because it was a big-ass check. And then he gave me the check. I fucked around and put the check in my pocket. I never cashed the check, so I had to call him back and ask him to get the check back. Because I didn't know about checks. I was just so used to dealing with cash. So I never wanted to fuck with checks. I thought that was some lame shit. But for the record now, I'm going to sit down and get another check, because I know checks are important. You should want a check, too. Get your check. Checks are good. Cash is better. Checks are great. It's the motto. Cash your checks. You and that camera going to get me in trouble.
In a game that is notorious for hype and exaggeration, Jeezy seemed to be more thoughtful than his persona implied, an enigma of types. He had all the trappings of the rap game, strategic partnerships with Adidas and Belvedere, a clothing line, 8732, and his own record label, CTE.
You see my view? It's London, y'all. Y'all come check this shit out. Fuck. Got locked. They must have wanted a nigga to jump out this bitch. It's London, my nigga. Look at that shit. You know what I'm saying? It's nice, right? It's real shit, man. Just think about where a nigga came from. See, this is standing in this window and just look. I wonder what the first thing on my mind is. Where is the weed man?
Right. I remember when we were standing there and you was like, I took it from the trailer park. He's like, I'm stomping my feet.
Yeah.
London.
I stomped on that brick because I know nobody from my walk of life, my neighborhoods, anywhere I've ever been, anywhere I've ever got out, anybody I ever got out with, ever touched that one brick.
It was soon obvious that he wanted to tell his story, but in his words, and the words of the people that really knew him. This is that story. For the most part, Jeezy's early life was pretty normal. He was born Jay Jenkins on the 28th of September, 1977, a native of the Dirty South, the son of regular working class parents.
I thought having a baby was the most terrible thing in the world, because I never really had a baby natural birth. I can't say the only thing I know, I was cut old, baby was there, and it was out, boom. That's the situation.
Well, being that Jay was the firstborn, that was back in 1977, I feel like any father would feel, you know, your first child, you're excited, you know, you're about to be a parent, and you just go from there.
His father was a Marine, a profession that would provide financial security, but emotionally, It was hard on young Jay.
The Marine Corps back in those days, they had one mentality. If they want you to have a family, they'd have issued you one. So the Marine Corps priorities came first. And it used to bother him sometimes. I would go to work on a Monday. It may be 3-4 weeks later before I showed back up again. But we had, I think we had a normal family.
I mean, I remember a vacation or two. Like, I'd be lying if I said I didn't. You know, I remember, Pop's trying to put some other things together to get us out of where we was. I remember, maybe a good Christmas or so.
Eventually, the pressures of military life would take its toll.
No, I told him I wanted to leave, and he told me, fine, Danny. So he loaded us up, and he brought us to my mother's house. And he went back. Yep, and that's what it was.
Uprooted from North Carolina, Jay now faced a new life in Hawkinsville, a small Georgia town with a population less than 4,000. Like most kids faced with the separation of their parents, Jay and his sister Trina found it hard to adjust to the new situation.
When we were staying with my mother, they would hear me cry a lot at night. And they would always tell me, Mama, you're gonna be all right.
But after the separation, Jeezy's father filed for divorce. Money was tight, but Sharon did her best to provide for herself and her young family, working any minimum wage job that was going. Eventually scratching out a living, cleaning houses. Managing to scrape together $10,000, she moved herself and her family into a small trailer.
When we came to Hawkinsville and my mom and dad got a divorce is when my brother became more distant from my dad.
Like, I didn't talk to him, like, period. Like, I wouldn't even talk to him. Like, I see him just walk the other way, like, nah, I ain't. Because I feel like, he let us down at the time. Because when he left, like, my mom was all.
Devastated by the divorce and plagued by depression, Jay's mother began to abuse alcohol and eventually drugs.
You know what I'm saying?
You blamed him for that?
In a sense, yeah. Because he had his life. You know what I'm saying? I don't know what really, I never really asked him what happened with him and her. You know what I'm saying? But I saw it. So I'm assuming somebody did something wrong. So I couldn't do nothing but respect it. But it's like he just moved on. And we was just there.
There were very long, cold nights and stuff, and that was something that he couldn't handle.
Though he didn't like to admit it, Jay had taken on the responsibility of being the man of the house, a responsibility that weighed heavy on his young shoulders. It was the 80s. The crack epidemic had hit hard. Not just in the big cities, but it had also made its way into small town America too.
When you get some money, I need some money. He was like, all right.
Young Jay was not immune to the devastation it was causing. He also couldn't ignore the possibilities it was creating around him.
The center, I was like, put me on. Person, I didn't know what I was doing. I just wanted to do it.
You're probably 12, 13?
Yeah, probably 11. But I just wanted to do it because I just wanted out. It was like this thing. I get out of school, I ride my bicycle all day, up and down the street, 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 all day. That's all I did. I ain't hang with niggas, I ain't do nothing. I was in my own world. I used to walk all day, all night, walk. 3-4 o'clock in the morning, walk, I'm standing on the corner, walking. You know what I mean? And that's what I did. And niggas was like, I just do that and go to school. Get up, go to school like everybody else.
How do you be a 12-year-old kid and you fucking stay out all night? You're not getting a whooping?
I didn't ever get that. Okay. Only person that ever beat me was my auntie, baby, my mama. But my mama used to talk to me in such a way, like she made me a man. Like my mama would say the craziest things. My sister was cool, but it was me that she hated. You know what I'm saying? And I know to this day, like my mama, like probably not now, as much as so as then, my mama hated me, man. I was like a fucking punching bag. That's why I had to leave her house.
Even though it seemed that violence had always been a part of his home life, eventually, things would come to a dangerous head with his mother.
And it was one morning he woke up and he didn't want to go to school. He thought he wasn't going to school. And he dropped and, talking to me. And I had a gun. I really did. And I told him, and I said, I asked the Lord to forgive me. Because I draw a lemon. He said, Mommy, if you draw that gun on me, you better kill me. I said, let me tell you something. I ain't finna kill you. You finna get out of my house. If you want to go, you going. If you don't want to stay, you don't have to stay. But you ain't going to come here and disrespect my house. I don't care what kind of house it is. You're going to respect me. And, you know, if you let your children start running over, you might well forget it. That's just it. That's when he said he piked up. He was living in Hawkinville with his grandmother. And his grandmother loved all her grandkids, and she let them do whatever they want to do.
It's my grandma's house right here. It's where it all went down, 616 Street. You stay on the block all day, every night. Come over here and post up. Say, my name Mailman. This is my Uncle Bo Slick, right? He gave me my first $40. I ain't looked back since. When I ain't been to this house since my grandma passed, man, that's like my heart. That's probably the only thing in the world I love. But like I say, my Uncle Bo Slick, you know what I mean, he stayed here now, but just seeing where, you know, they really come from, they got his roots from, like, this is how it
went. And you know what, when I used to rotate from my mother's house to my grandmother's house, because then you're in a house full of grown people, too, and you got motherfuckers smoking crack, stealing your school money, stealing your school clothes, you know what I'm saying? You got motherfuckers, you know what I mean, just doing all kind of just crazy shit, but it's normal, you know what I'm saying? Like, I'm taking it. But it's just me, because I ain't had no older brother. My older brother dead.
At the age of 16, Jay's mother had lost a child. And though it had happened before he was born, it was something Jay carried with him.
I know that I needed an older brother, you know what I'm saying? And I didn't have that, so I had to rely on the streets. You know what I'm saying? It was times that my father wasn't there, that I didn't have nobody to tell me you're doing the right thing or the wrong thing. I had to learn by trial and trial. All the hustlers, they gon'
ride to this. But you know the crazy shit? I learned through music. I learned through music and hang around older people.
He just loved that music. Every morning he would get up and sometimes that music sang like it's screaming and hollering, you know, but they really understood it. Every morning, not one morning, that music didn't scream and holler.
When I used to hear Master P say certain things, I just make it apply to my day. I just get around my homeboys and just like tell them things like, no, we can't pay that. We can't do that. Or if this happened, we gotta be like this. We gotta just stay as a clique, as a family. Loyalty in the word is a lifestyle. You can't be down with the moment, you gotta be down with the movement. It's death before dishonor.
Things were moving in all the right directions. Money in his pocket, a thriving business. But one night, when he found his mother at a local crack house, fate was about to remind the young Jay that every success comes at a cost.
He said something about seeing you on that couch. In that place, smoking drugs, and I think it really...
He probably saw me drunk. Because I drink alcohol. I don't lie to nobody, I drink.
And I'm gonna be real, like, I tell you, like, as a man, like, I serve my uncle, but nothing would prepare me to see, like, my mama, like, because I don't even know, like, how do I approach that, because I'm into it. Like, nigga, your mama in there? Like, nigga, no, and then nigga didn't even tell me that. I walked in, boom. Up on her, my first mom beat her ass. It's my mama. Crazy, my nigga. I remember being in the car, nigga, seeing one of my homeboys serve her. And it just fucked me all up. Cause in my mind, like as a hustler, I'm like, yo, what you doing over here with that? But like, I see you serve my mama, like I'm mind boggled now. So it ain't about the fact that you over here where you're not supposed to be fucking with people. You just gave my mama a fucking 20 rock, nigga, I seen it. I'm not crazy, I know what y'all did, I do this shit. So that's just, it just fucked me up.
Well, how did you feel? Was it humiliation, embarrassment, sadness?
No, it was a reality check. It was just like, what the fuck? Like, she's really, that's what she do.
I have tried it, and I'm not gonna lie, I'm 52 years old, going on 53. So I have tried it. And I can't sit up here and say that I didn't, because people know me, know I done tried it.
So that's just, it just fucked me up. And it just made me the way I am today. That's why I am. That's why I don't fuck with niggas. I don't fuck with people. That's why I am the way I am. When people say things to me, I don't give a fuck. You can't never tell me shit. You ain't been where I've been. I ain't even saying until I was abused as a kid and sexually molested, nigga. But shit, you tell me what's worse than you thinking something your way out, and it's taking your mama out, and you gotta continue to do it.
After several run-ins with the local authorities, Jay was offered an ultimatum. Jay didn't realize it then, but this ultimatum would change everything.
Kink was for making. I had never been to Macon, you know what I'm saying? So I was like, well, shit, you know, like, shit, you know, he was just a cool nigga.
I don't know, somebody was talking about some weed or something.
You know,
I'm
telling nigga, like, yeah, nigga, you know, I be smoking this shit. He's like, nigga, I don't smoke no more. I'm like, why?
Like, I smoked some weed one time. That shit made me wigged out. And he said,
nigga, me too.
And from us, from a weed incident, I mean, we became best friends. Like, we had a big dream. Like, we wanted to get out, man, get some money. We just really, you know, we talked about getting our GED while I was, because that was the basis of it, to get your GED. We'll get back in these streets and get some money.
The loyalty that we had for each other, you know, we just kind of just stayed down and just, you know, kept it, try to keep each other out of trouble.
Two amigos.
But after boot camp, the two amigos went their separate ways. Kink went back to Macon, and Jay, well, Jay headed back to Hawkinsville, fighting for and winning the right to be a father to his son. He had always known that he wanted more than a backwoods trailer park could offer. But now, as a father, that want became a need. It was time to get the two amigos back together. Inspired by the musical entrepreneurs of his formative years, like Cash Money, he formulated a plan. He and Kink would start a label, Young Guns Entertainment. And that label would bring their hood to the masses.
Or the whole studio ain't know how to work nothing in that motherfucker.
For the first time in a long time, Kink and Jay's plans looked like they were going to be derailed. And after their last artist was indicted on a murder charge, things looked pretty bleak for Young Guns Entertainment.
That nigga said, shit. You wanna try this shit?
And in an instant, Young Guns Entertainment became CTE, and Jay Jenkins became Young Jeezy. Though understandably nervous at first, Jeezy began to realize that he had talent, real talent.
Yeah, it'll be like, you know, I'm just saying shit, because I'm talking to myself, like hyping me up. So as I'm rapping, I'm just hyping myself up. And I put together a little album and shit, done with this CD. You know what I'm saying? I went and broke bread with everybody. I don't give a fuck. Actually, niggas, Pastor Troy, all niggas, I broke bread with them niggas. Niggas know I came with the Kroger bag.
Yeah, I was DJ ripping it down, boom, boom, doing what I do, and Fabulous was in the club. And Fabulous grabbed the mic and started ripping it down on top of the bar. Like, you know, we just having a good time. And he's like, yo, let my man Jeezy rock. And I was like, I ain't know Jeezy was an artist. So he grabbed the mic, and they told me to play a certain record. And I played the record. And he's performing, the whole place loses their mind.
Yeah, I remember being in the club, seeing Jermaine Dupri, T.I., all these niggas come through, Big Boy. I just be mad as a motherfucker. Because I had a chain and a car, just like, but nobody knew who the fuck I was. Like, I wanted to be more than what niggas wanted me to be. I wanted to be more than what I thought I wanted to be.
Atlanta strip club had long been ground zero for two things. Music and money. And as usual, Jeezy had the foresight to use both to his advantage.
They all bring their song to the strip club, and they gonna come to me, or they gonna come to the White Chocolates, or they gonna come to the different girls in the club and say, look, I'm getting ready to play this, I need y'all to go in on this shit, you know?
A lot of what Jeezy was doing came along with, you know, his affiliation with the family, with BMF.
Jeezy's friendships were beginning to raise suspicion, especially his longtime friendship with Big Meech. Big Meech was the alleged leader of the Black Mafia family, an Atlanta-based drug syndicate that, according to the FBI, was one of the largest cocaine cartels in American history.
Dude was my nigga, and nobody ever gave me shit. Nobody ever backed me. I backed me, Kink backed me. And, you know, bottom line, that's what that was.
Jeezy attacked his music with an unparalleled commitment. Sure, that was nothing anyone could teach him about the streets, but Jeezy was the first to admit that this was a whole new game. So just like before, he and Kink set about recruiting a trusted team.
And we ran into this guy, it was a new producer, the name Shawty Red.
When I met Jeezy, you know what I'm saying, we were just out in the club.
He would play shit, and I'd be like, every time he played a sound, like, he just pulled an emotion out of me. Like,
Jeezy, Kink, and now Shawty Red were creating a phenomenon. No one had ever heard anything quite like it before.
Dad, think what you speak. Think what you speak right here.
Jeezy has one of the most magical qualities that any rapper can have, which is that he's believable. You believe him from the moment he came in.
Sure, Streets Is Watching was big, but nothing would compare to Young Jeezy's next mixtape, Trap or Die.
I remember the first time I heard the intro to the tape. And it gave me chills.
With the help of mixtape king DJ Drama, Trap or Die sold over 200,000 units in the streets and was the first mixtape to be heard nationwide.
Trap or Die, this huge underground buzz on what he was doing and, you know, what he's about to do, you know. And I just was trying to encourage them to continue on that movement, because sometimes, you know, movements are bigger than, you know, single records. You know, sometimes people have big records or have one record and no one buys the album because they don't buy into the person. With Jeezy, this is a different thing.
It was someone who was speaking the language of the streets.
You really getting money and hustlers, like, you can listen to their music and really understand, like, this motherfucker really been through this and knows what he talking about.
Jeezy was beginning to find out who he really was as an artist. He'd harnessed the energy of the street, given a voice to the people who had so often been ignored or demonized. But where now? What now? But like anyone facing change, he was unsure what was over the horizon.
We can't enter into this game with the same attitude or mentality that we had in the other game. We got to leave it there. Or else we just take ourselves through a whole lot of unnecessary stress and strain. That's the best piece of advice that I could give someone of our stature who leaves that side of life in hopes of entering this side of life. You got to know what to leave and what to bring with you.
Whether he liked it or not, Jeezy was all in. And with so many copies of Trap or Die sold, it wasn't long before the major record companies began to take notice. Before he knew it, Jeezy was in the middle of a major label bidding war. But no one fought harder than Shakir Stewart, a savvy Def Jam executive who lived in Atlanta and was right-hand man to music mogul L.A. Reid. Def Jam was about to find out just how different an artist Jeezy was.
I left and I said, no, fuck that, fuck y'all money, I'm not changing. Because they didn't get it. So they was like, nah. I'm like, fuck y'all, I don't need y'all money, I'm cool, I'm good. And Jeezy, I'm like, oh man, what are you doing? I'm like, nah, fuck that, I'm not going for that.
Eventually, Def Jam would realize that Jeezy and Kink weren't just looking for a record deal. They were looking for a partnership. Partners to take Jeezy and CTE to the next level.
I want to shoot two videos, so I shot Money Over Here, then I shot Air Forces. If you ever see the Air Forces video, that video is crazy to me because there's only like maybe 20 niggas standing there, us standing between all silver Ferraris and Phantoms and GTs and all this shit. But it's like, when I see it, I can't even watch it to this day because everybody in the picture there in jail was crazy. Only one person is alive. That shit's like, whoa, you know what I mean? But when I got it done, I went up to LA's office. I bust up in there and shit with my new little kid on. Like, yo, man, this is my video, man. Whatever y'all gonna do. And I showed it to everybody in the room. And when that video was done, like, it went from Money Over Here, balling, having fun, to that serious Air Forces, then it just stopped. Then they looked at me, and they said, I get it. I see who you are, though. And he was like, whatever you're doing,
you don't need to do it anymore. I got you from here.
Mama, I said, what? I just signed a contract, and you ain't got to work another day of your life. You ain't got to clean nobody else's house.
Everything is moving forward for Young Jeezy. While working on his first album for Def Jam, his hustle does not stop. He signs a side deal with Diddy and Bad Boy Records to be part of the group Boys in the Hood.
I'm proud to say Jeezy was on Bad Boy Records. Jeezy's the only artist that was on Bad Boy and Def Jam at the same time.
The excitement in the business was infectious. Everyone knew that Young Jeezy was destined to be big. But just weeks into recording the debut album and while on a video shoot for Fabulous, Jeezy was struck down with Bell's palsy.
He couldn't close his eyes. He couldn't do nothing. And when they did that, I was kind of scared. I never know nobody had nothing like that.
Bell's palsy is a condition where the nerve that supplies the muscles to one side of the face stop working. 2 out of 10,000 people are affected with Bell's palsy.
Thankfully, his recovery was swift, so he was eager to make up for lost time. And in typical Jeezy style, he took on a punishing tour schedule. He was hit with yet another medical issue, one that could potentially end his career.
Gotta show Jacksonville. Keep in mind, I never been taught how to perform. So I show up Jacksonville, 3-4 tour buses full of niggas from my neighborhood. They go do the show. But I'm so amped up, cause it's big, like one of the biggest things I've done, Super Bowl. So I get on the stage, and the sound system so fucked up, cause there's so many people in there, that I'm yelling, I'm screaming, yeah. And in the middle, like right at the end of my performance, I just said something, and I felt it. And I just remember my shit just like my throat had this burn sensation. It was just burning up, burning up, burning up. And I'm just got all me and all my niggas, and I'm just like, yo, I'm fucked up.
One day, he just stopped talking.
Here I am. I'm almost home. I'm hot as a motherfucker. Everybody fucking with me. And I can't talk.
Jeezy was diagnosed with polyps on his vocal cords, a serious condition that could have far-reaching consequences.
He couldn't even talk. They was doing sign language. He couldn't smile. He couldn't do nothing.
You now have a building full of people that are excited about you, that are excited about this artist that's new to us, and he can't work. He can't do anything.
So my man sit down, we talk. He's like, I've been talking to the doctor, you're gonna have to have surgery. You know, I'm telling the nigga, like, I don't have no insurance, dog. I can't, how am I gonna get surgery?
You know, we were just afraid that that momentum would be lost, and we didn't know what was gonna happen after the surgery. There was a chance that he would never talk again, his voice could change. We just didn't know, so it was a really scary time.
As Jeezy lay on the operating table, his career hung in the balance.
It would have been over for us, as far as us getting up out the prior situation that we was in. Like, that's what we wanted to get in the music business for, leave what we was doing alone to not wind up in the penitentiary. So, and now here we come, we run into a brick wall, another obstacle.
Jeezy tried his best to remain optimistic, but he had a lot on the line. Before his surgery, he had recorded So Icy, a track with fellow Atlanta rapper Gucci Mane, and the single had blown up. He was hotter than ever, but he knew that unless he followed doctor's orders and took time to recover, it could all be over. So when Gucci Mane's people approached him to do a show to capitalize on So Icy's success, Jeezy had no alternative but to turn them down.
I remember fucking just not being able to talk to nobody. And I didn't want nobody, because I felt like it was a vulnerable state, so I didn't want people around me. So I only had certain people that came and that could communicate with me.
He couldn't do the show, so, you know, I don't know if they felt the way or whatnot, but, you know, maybe they didn't understand. He probably had people in their ears, like, you know, like Jeezy, you know, acting funny or whatnot, but that wasn't the case. Like, he couldn't speak. He just had the surgery.
I can't talk. I'm in the bed rest. Round one, Gucci Mane versus Jeezy.
Inexplicably, somehow, from his hospital bed, Jeezy was now embroiled in a full-fledged rap beef.
You been played. You feel like a nigga's trying you. I didn't look at it as rap shit. I don't do rap beef. That's for rappers, my nigga. So, all this going on, and I'm just sitting there, and I'm just rebuilding my strength, and, you know, just keeping praying in my head, and I'm just hearing this melody in my head. And I ain't even writing this shit. And I'm just like, you know what I mean? Like, snowman, bitch, man. And I just went in the studio without nobody. And I couldn't even talk. And I just went in there, and that shit killed me. It hurt every bone in my body. But I rapped that motherfucking song. And I put that shit out. And I went back home. And my phone never stopped ringing. And it was like, yeah, nigga, that's how the fuck you handle that shit.
Jeezy was back. Not fully recovered, but well enough to finish the long-awaited debut album with Def Jam. People on the streets were feeling it. Jeezy would soon learn that the hood code would not always translate to the music business. Sure, this was a hustle, but the rules that he lived by weren't necessarily followed by everyone.
I was in the club. I was at the Body Tap. I never forget it. Like, it was DJ X-Ray. He was playing some songs off the album. I'm like, whoa. And I called Kink. I'm like, Kink, we got trouble. The album is out. The whole album is out.
After some quick detective work, the leak was traced back to a certain intern who had tried and failed to push his beats for the new album.
I called Cuz. I'm like, yo, my nigga, we got a problem. This album got leaked out. So he didn't say nothing at first. And the motherfucker just snapped.
Jumped up, grabbed my AK, threw that bitch in the back of my Porsche truck, tore my whole garage up. I was so furious. Like, this is my only shot. This nigga just gave it away for nothing. I know he did. You know what I'm saying?
We knew what we had. We knew the potential. We knew that everybody was waiting for this album.
And then the album came out. I sold 200,000. And he was like, that's all right. I'm like, all right. Yeah, that's all right. Then I sold another 100-something thousand next week. Another 100-something thousand the next week. Another 100-something thousand the next week. Now I'm going. Now I'm in the middle of fucking Brooklyn shooting Soul Survivor. And every real nigga from Brooklyn is out there. I got niggas from Harlem out there. Nigga Jay-Z came out there, motherfucker. Now I remember being banned. Cause I thought I stood for something good. I was like, damn, I'm Slim Man, nigga. Like, I'm the nigga who made it. Like, I'm the nigga, I'm the Malcolm X. But then the world went like, nigga. Like, yeah, you sold 2 million records. We're not fucking with you, boy. Because they was like the music. They weren't fucking with the music. They were saying that, you know, I had a certain type of music and they banned me. They tried to ban me, bro. I mean, like, they made it a problem.
Mr. 17-5 Snowman, that was something that he coined for himself. Only the subculture of, you know, street cats knew what it really was. But, you know, on a broader scale, it was something that, you know, a 5-year-old could recognize and a 55-year-old could recognize.
So instead of me being this big ass superstar getting all these endorsements and all this, it's like, no, he like that, we can't let him in.
Jeezy had never shied away from his past. He'd always been honest about where he'd come from. It was right there in his music. But ironically, the honesty that had made him famous would also make him a target. He was now to be investigated as part of the federal BMF investigation.
BMF and CTE, it just was extended family. It was nothing, you know, nothing ever tied. It was just really extended family.
They were trying to link Jeezy to the BMF crime family. Though he managed to avoid indictment, the experience had made Jeezy realize that unlike the other Fortune 500 CEOs he had modeled himself on, his past would always be part of his future.
If I'm in the street and someone has a chance to make it somewhere, then I have to let them go. You know, I have friends, real friends, that I live a different life with, who purposely removed themselves, that I have to force them to come see me. And they're like, nah, I don't want to, you know, like, I don't want to cause any trouble. That they stay away on purpose and they come around once a year. And these are people that I spend years with. You know, that's a true friend. Someone who removed themselves from the process, knowing that what they're into can hinder you.
I get both sides. I get the big industry shit, because I know all the label heads. And I get the street shit. There's no way you can be everything for everybody. Sometimes you gotta just show on the play. I can't stand on the block forever. And every day people just tell me, oh, you need to move out of Atlanta. You need to do this, you need to do that. Like, what do you need to do though? I'm cool with who I am. I'm content with that. Every day I get up and I tell me, man, I love me some me, man. I don't give a fuck. Nobody say I love me some me, man. Cause I know me ain't gonna never let me down. I don't, even when the pain is excruciating, homie, and there ain't nobody to talk to because nobody else understands. Who else understands? All my friends are dead in jail, literally.
The reality is, for Jeezy, the streets aren't some place you drive through when you're lost or raise an eyebrow at when you watch them on TV. For him, the streets are everything. He never brags about his charities or the work he does for them because the impact he has on their lives speaks for itself. So when he started his charity Street Dreams in 2001, there was no fanfare, no self-promotion. Just the simple act of a man giving back to his family.
I had heard about this and I said, well, you know, it's worth a try. Maybe I'll go ahead and enter. And it was, you had to write an essay about what did you want to make your dreams come true. To me, I just needed a wheelchair accessible van for my son. I was working, going to school, and we had a Tahoe. We were literally picking him up out of the chair and putting him in and breaking the wheelchair down. So we did that every time we had to go somewhere, every time. Or I just didn't go, you know. So I wrote in, and basically that's what I said, you know. My ultimate dream would be to have a wheelchair accessible van for my son so we can go places and do things, because it was just getting very hard doing that each time. Most of the time it was just me. My husband's in the military, so he's not there much, you know. So it was mainly me doing that. I see the van, and I'm just like, I can't believe it, you know. I tell people all the time, you know, they're like, wow, you know, where'd you get that van or whatever? And I was like, you know, Jeezy brought me this van, you know, and they're like, yeah, right. I'm like, no, I'm serious. It's just amazing.
You know, I could probably very well just be a politician. How you think I wrote the recession? That one because I was a dumb nigga talking about getting high and fucking, you know, fucking bitches and fucking driving Benzes. That was because I understood what the fuck was going on. I saw that it was about to be a recession. Niggas in the hood didn't even know what that word mean. Half niggas can't spell it. You know what I'm saying? Like, they didn't know. Like, what the fuck is that? Nigga, that's a drought. You know what it is. You just don't know what it is.
He had the only album that spoke to where the world was at that time. And everyone else, you know, as the world changed, they tried to catch up through remixes or so on and so forth. He has the only album out from a rap artist, for sure, that documents that point in history.
Feeling the pressure from the label to become a crossover artist, Jeezy stops recording TM-103 and joins Jay-Z on the BP3 tour. Jeezy also delivers a number one record, Lose My Mind.
Voice Award is
Rihanna featuring Young Jeezy, hard.
Everything I have, I don't cherish it. Everywhere I live, have to live, I don't cherish it. I don't look at things like they're mine, you know? I remember hustling for tennis shoes. I went in the closet today to get dressed. I probably got over 5,000-6,000 pair of shoes. And I don't even look at it like that. I don't even look at it as my stuff. You know what I'm saying? It's like somebody let me borrow it. Because the things that I've accumulated, they don't mean shit. I want what's on the other side. I want the name. I want the respect. I got homies right now today, like, oh, you worried too much. No, you ain't worried enough, nigga. You content. You can stay here all you want. I'm not staying here. I'm not staying here because the more I stay here, the more my past catches up to me. The more I stay here, the more my past, where I came from, comes to haunt me, my nigga. I gotta keep it moving.
Jeezy is an artist that came from the streets. So I think he has to always have that connection to the streets. But he has to understand that he has to be able to be accessible to the streets, and he has to have a connection to them, but he can't let the streets bring him down. He's one of the special ones. A lot of people can't go back to their hood and get that love. A lot of people can't walk through the streets. You know, he has the opportunity to be able to walk through the streets, be that ghetto superstar, but also be, you know, that next leader that we need.
So what's next for this trapper? Well, seems he's come full circle. Ironically, and through no fault of his own, the things he has spent his life trying to avoid have managed to catch up with him. Death and jail time have impacted the completion of his next album. Longtime friend and ally Shakir Stewart sadly committed suicide. So as it was in the beginning, it's just him and Kink. But somehow you get the feeling Jeezy wouldn't want it any other way.
I can't be who you want me to be. I can be who the streets chose me to be, and that's a real nigga, and to represent them the best way I can. So to make it to me is to be at a place where no matter what, I'm respected. I want to be what Pac wasn't. You know what I'm saying? I want to be what Big couldn't be. I didn't do what everybody else did because it worked for them. I did what Jeezy did. I did it the Jeezy way. And if I'm respected after it's said and done, I made it. If not, you fucked up.
Used to call me sick with a stamp in the middle. Yes. And you can tell the color when it's pants up. I put your if you represent your clip. Yes. Money in there. If you ever hit a lick, yes. Money in there. You know that you have all. Real, but it's as real as it.
The absolute truth, yeah, no joke. Who me? I emerged from the